Hey guys, welcome to the MOV podcast. This is episode 9, and this is a special one for us because of the number 9. Like 9 November 2019, last year, we did the Mad Over Videos event, which is the reason why we are doing the podcast. Because of pandemic, we couldn't pull off that event this year. And today is the 9th episode, and another special reason of the episode is the guest that we have today. Again, somebody I've been looking forward to host on this podcast for a really long time. Like before we add the guest on the show, I'd quickly like to show you a little bit of a small sneak peek into what happened last year on Mad Over Videos, the event. And then we'll quickly add the guest.
On November 9th in Bangalore, a tribe of 200 marketeers came together and went mad over videos. Here's what happened. We had India's top video marketing experts share their trade secrets through fantastic keynotes. The anatomy of a viral video.
Why are you, all of you, excited about video marketing and videos? Because videos are exploding on tiny screens everywhere.
Targeting the 9-second attention span generation.
So in 9 seconds, your audience would form an opinion and either outrage or move on.
Videos that move hearts.
You must understand the power of the audience.
And much, much more. But it wasn't just talk, talk, talk. We had freaking awesome workshops.
There is a requirement. There is a delivery. Client dies. I mean, you deliver.
Insightful ad analysis sessions.
I'm going to talk about how you can break down complex ideas to visuals.
And mind-blowing new technologies.
First, break their expectations. And for that, you have to give them the unexpected.
Together we learned, shared ideas, and made amazing new friendships. We sparked the beginning of India's first video marketing movement, creating a kick-ass community of video marketing ninjas. Join us in growing this family and see you for the next edition of Mad Over Videos.
So that was Mad Over Videos, and this is our guest, Nick Bennett.
Hey, thanks for having me. How are you doing?
I'm doing very well. Thank you so much, Nick, for taking out time and joining us today. I've been trying to bring you on for a long time. I think it's a great thing that you made it today, and on this 9th episode, I think it's a special thing for me as well.
Absolutely, I'm excited to be here.
Awesome. I'd quickly like to get started. I don't think so. I've done your introduction till now, so I'd like you to introduce yourself. I mean, we all know that you're the director of film marketing at Logs, but then just tell us a brief about what your background has been.
Yeah, definitely. So as you said, I'm the director of film marketing for Logs.io. I've been working for startups now for the last couple of years. It's kind of what I enjoy. You know, outside of work, I play baseball. I'm big into sports. So really into that and trying to stay active. Plus, I have a 2-year-old daughter, so she keeps me very active as well. And yeah, I mean, I'm just really... My goal is to help be the voice for other field marketers out there, and let people know that field marketing is not dead, it's transformed. So
absolutely. I think what you said just said that you want to be the voice of other field marketers, and you are, in fact. Like, that's how I discovered you, right? I saw your posts on LinkedIn. I was watching a few of those, and then I happened to send you a connection request. We connected, and I think it also shows that creating quality content is something that makes reputation and puts you out there, right? Please tell me what has been the success or the secret behind your success of the content that you put out on LinkedIn.
Yeah, you know, it's funny because I was always the type of person on LinkedIn that would just browse content. I never commented. I never posted my own stuff. It was basically 100% work related. I would basically share a post when someone told me to share a post. And when the pandemic happened in March in the US specifically, and things started to get shut down, I said, okay, my previous company, I had a VP of growth and enablement. He put out a question to us and said, you know, this is the opportunity to build your personal brand and start to take it to the next level. So I started to create content daily. Literally, I started Monday through Friday. I try to stay away from the weekends. Occasionally, it will go in there. But the biggest thing that I've noticed is you need to provide value. And on top of that, you need to engage with other like-minded people that you want to be connected with. And it was funny, you know, when I started out, I only had about 2,000 followers on LinkedIn, and I'm actually just about to hit 10,000. I'm super close. And all of that happened within like a 6-month window. And there's no hacks to it. You have to grind. You have to be able to put in the work, because what you put in is what you get out of it. And the amount of people that I've been able to meet these last couple of months, and just being able to be part of these podcasts and just be able to get the message out there, wouldn't have been possible if I didn't start to create content every day. And I just, you know, my goal is to really just provide value and engagement. Those are the two things that I go for. And if I can do those two things and I make at least one person happy, then I've done my job.
I think you've ended up engaging a lot more than one person. I think you've been doing pretty well. And you just mentioned about consistency. Why don't you tell me how important is being consistent with content? I mean, all of us come up with one good content piece once in a while, and it does really well, and then we all go back into our shells. I think we all come back after a month, and then we try to put another one, and that flops, right? Like, how important is consistency?
Yeah, consistency is key, because what's going to happen is, you know, like you said, you may come up with like one piece here, and then you're going to fall off from it, and you're going to say, okay, yeah, I'll get to it when I get to it. But then you may not post again for a couple weeks out. And if you keep on doing that, it's just going to snowball, and it's just going to, you know, you're just going to fall out of it. Like, you have to consistently, people say 2 to 3 times a week. I honestly think daily. Like, I don't want this platform of LinkedIn to become another Facebook, where it's basically everyone just putting, you know, what they had for lunch every day. I want it to provide actual value. And that's one of the biggest things that drew me to it. Like, I want to meet other marketers and like-minded people that I can learn from, because we're all trying to up-level our careers. We want to all take it to that next step. And I feel like that's such a good platform to be able to do that. And it's important to stay consistent in both the posting as well as engaging with other people.
Absolutely. I think even I did not realize the power of LinkedIn for a bunch of like years, I think, because I had my LinkedIn account created long, long back towards the start of my career, and it was just dormant. I had to like go back, reset my password in order to like take charge of my account when I actually started coming back. Right. That shows how much people are valuing LinkedIn right now. Right. For somebody to come back from like oblivion and then now sort of be so active. Someone like me, who's like right now doing a podcast almost every single day. It's insane. Right. Everybody is seeing the power of the platform. And I just happened to read a post today. Was very interesting saying that the original poster just mentioned that he happened to speak with the CMO, and the CMO said, I've not seen a sale coming from a podcast. And that's such a I don't know, it's possibly the stupidest thing that a CMO could say, right?
Yeah, I mean, it all comes back to the personal brand too that everyone's trying to build right now. It's, you know, I can 100% say that the personal brand that you build on LinkedIn 100% ties back to the company that you work for. And you may not be able to directly measure the results that come from it, but I can 100% tell you that the brand that is going to be elevated. And I mean, people, when they think of my name on LinkedIn, they know exactly where I work, because it's just, it kind of goes hand in hand. And likewise for me, there's certain people that I follow every single day. And like, when I see them pop up, like, I just know, okay, this person works for there. And those are the people where if I ever need anything or like a service of that company, those are probably going to be the first people that I go to as well.
Yeah. I think on that note, I'd like to know who are your favorite marketers who are doing it right on LinkedIn, and which are the brands who are doing it right on LinkedIn?
Yeah, definitely. So there's a couple brands that come to mind that are doing this really, really well right now. Obviously, Gravy is a big brand that's well known. So you got Tara, you've got Casey. There's a bunch of them that are posting content daily. Honestly, the Gong team is another big team. Yeah, exactly. And big shout out to Danny over there. Danny on the marketing team does an amazing job along with Udi. And they do an excellent job, and like everything that they put out is awesome. Drift is another company that's absolutely crushing it. And honestly, you know, the company that I came from, Clary, they put out really, really strong content. And that's kind of where I got my start. And a lot of people still connect me to being there. And just they think, okay, you know, Nick was from Clary, and like now they're starting to realize, okay, you know, now he's at Logs. And I'm trying to get more people on the Logs team to start to kind of build their brands as well. And like, I've had a bunch of conversations like internally of like, you know, hey, these are the results that can happen. Like, it's important to start to get out there and try to do these things. And, you know, my thought is 90% of what you put on LinkedIn should be about your personal brand. 10% should be about work-related things, because everyone can hit the share button of like, okay, here's a webinar that's going on. But like, people really care when you provide value.
Right. I think, like you said, everybody knows the brand because of a few star marketers. I think I did not know about Drift before like I knew about Dave. And I got to know about them. And they're quite a big brand. I mean, I started realizing how big they are only when I found them out because of Dave. The same goes with Gong. I think I love the consistency at which everybody posts. I think I'm not sure. There was a rumor going around that they don't get their paychecks if they don't post on LinkedIn. That's how consistent and that's how good they are at posting content on LinkedIn. I think all of these that we name are startups, and you see why they value making content so much, right? When you don't have large marketing budgets to spend on PPC, etc., you always go back to content, right?
Right. Exactly right. Yeah. And I mean, that's so important, especially, and then you throw a pandemic on top of that. I mean, marketing budgets are basically cut, but you still are expected to get the same results or maybe even more. And it's like, everyone's trying to find that silver bullet right now.
That's true. You yourself come from a bunch of startups. I think two of them have been IPO'd. Tell me your journey. What has been working at startups like?
Yeah, honestly, so you know, I kind of came across a startup by chance. Like, I never knew that this was even what I wanted to do. And this is Logs is my fifth startup right now. And my previous to Logs, I was at Clary, so they're still going. The three companies I was with before that all actually were acquired. One IPO'd and then the other ended up getting acquired, but all three ultimately ended up being acquired. And I've just been like riding that wave. Honestly, you wear so many different hats, and there's no red tape. Like, no one's going to point a finger at you and tell you that you suck or like that something's terrible. Like, we're all in the same boat trying to make it work together. And it allows so much creativity and to think outside the box, because especially with everything that's going on, like, we're all trying to do the same thing. Who's going to stick out first? And those people are going to be the ones that are most successful. And honestly, I could probably never go back to work for a mega company. Like, it's just not my style. It's, you know, I love the grind. I love being able to build something from nothing and see it come to fruition, and then be able to be like, you know, look back a couple of years and be like, I made that.
Yep. I think once you are in that fast paced environment and you see your work go to the consumer and you see the returns on that really quick compared to a large corporation, that's something very satisfying. I think personally also, I like to I like the ordered chaos, right? I like to say there is order to that chaos, because there are a lot of people who ensure that every experiment that they do, however random it is not actually random, because it's all linked to a certain goal and it's measured. But it's so brilliant to walk into work every single day and have a new thing to do, right?
Exactly. And that's one of the big things why I like field marketing so much is people ask me like, what's your day-to-day look like? Literally every day is completely different. That's what I love. Like I'm not the type of person that could do the same thing Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, like 9 to 5 every single day. Like I need that variety and I need that excitement. And this is like perfect for me.
Absolutely. Also, like what comes with that excitement is that the sort of downside to this is you have fewer resources, right? So you have to sort of optimize everything, try to get the best out of whatever you have. And I'd like to point out this or bring up this quote that I recently read. I think it was by Gary Vee, where you don't have coins to spend, you spend sweat, right?
Exactly. Yeah, it's all about the sweat equity. And it's just like, you know, especially depending on what stage, like if you're an early stage, like pre-seed company, or even like an A stage, like the team varies and it all depends where your ARR is as well. And like, as you grow, hopefully you start to expand the team, but like you have to not be afraid that like, regardless of what your title is, you're going to roll up your sleeves and it's going to get tactical as well as strategic. But like, people that just think, okay, you know, hey, this is going to kind of, you know, I'm going to have other people do this for me. Like that doesn't work in startups. Like you need to be able to grind and like, you need to be able to roll up your sleeves and just be able to jump in whenever someone needs help.
True. That brings me to the point. I want to know, what does a typical day for you look like? I mean, you can tell me one, how does a typical day look like today in, when we are in the middle of pandemic? And then before, I think you were at Clary when the pandemic, before the pandemic hit. And you can just walk me through the life of a field marketing director. What goes on?
Yeah, I mean, and like I said, you know, every day is different. So like the big thing for me is sales is my customer. So my goal is to drive pipeline for sales. And so whether that's joining sales calls, whether that's joining, you know, prospect or customer calls, whether it's planning events. Right now, everything's virtual, of course, but before, you know, it was a lot of in-person events, both geography-based as well as kind of larger scale. It's working cross-functionally with not only every piece of marketing, whether you're, you know, your demand gen team, your content team, your product marketing team, you're kind of like the quarterback to everything and you're pulling it all together to execute. And like, I like to say, you know, you're kind of the CMO of your specific region or territory. Like you're the go-to person. You're the one that's helping create that plan for go-to-market that's hopefully driving results. And now that everything's virtual, it's fatigue is starting to set in where, you know, people just are so over jumping on webinars and just anything. So you have to start to make them exciting. And if you're trying to do that in silo with basically marketing doing their thing, sales doing their thing, it's never going to work. Like you should be developing these plans in conjunction with sales. And what works in, say, Boston doesn't work in London. And like every single territory, region, country, it's all got to be specific to that place. And then specific also to your ICP. So every day is different. And that's what's so exciting about it.
Awesome. I like to make this point clear, because a lot of people expect every single marketing activity to result in a sale, or you need ROI on everything. And then I saw this post by Dave. He's currently with Privy now, but then he was with Drift when I think he made this post. I'm not sure, but I saw him hold a placard outside his office or outside his house, and that said everything need not be measured, and every marketing move need not have an ROI. I think a lot of things that you do to ensure the brand has recall value, has branding, because a lot of people who might be watching you right now, maybe they won't buy from you right now, but then when they know that they need something like that at a certain point in time and they're ready to buy, I think you are going to be at the top of their mind.
Exactly. And that's why it all comes back to the brand too. And it's just like you know, I completely agree with that. Not everything in marketing can be measured, but there's leaders that work in some companies and like they think that everything can or should be measured. And it's up to everyone else to basically change that mentality. Because think about LinkedIn, going back to LinkedIn for an example. there's when I was at Clary, we literally had, I had interactions with prospects on there that 100% converted to a opportunity just from a conversation. And that may not have been measured because it was just a relationship or a conversation through a thing. And it wasn't a specific program that was tracked, but relationships, and there's so many other things that can't be measured always, but do provide a ton of value. And I think it's just getting more marketing leaders and just leadership in general to understand that not everything can be measured.
Yeah, not everybody has the luck to have a CEO who understands and believes in marketing, right?
I mean, exactly. It's
brilliant if every CEO could understand what a marketing genius could bring to his team. we would all have been in a better place, but eventually I think you need to, like, because every function that a business invests in should somehow tie to revenue. I do believe that it has to guide revenue. It has to also, like you said, sales is going to be your internal customer. Right. Where you help them sell better. So a part of your marketing team can focus on sales enablement and things like that, or even in pre-sales. Like I just happened to read another LinkedIn post which said that marketing should actually get onto sales calls and help them sell better. What's your thought on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think marketing and sales should be tied at the hip. And I think it starts from the top down. If you have your CMO or VP of marketing like interlocked with the counterpart on the sales side, then it will push down. But if that's not there or the trust is broken, everyone's just going to try to do their own thing in silos. And then, you know, like you said, the ultimate goal is revenue. And if everyone's working in silos, it's never going to get to the point where you're truly achieving the predictable revenue that you want to achieve. And it's, you know, I jump on QBRs, I jump on, you know, sales team calls, and like not only fail marketing should be doing that, everyone in marketing should be doing that. And like, especially when you get into some of the marketing, like product marketing, and like they should be jumping on customer calls to get more quotes. They should be jumping on video to be able to do things with them as well. Like if it's not just one person in marketing that can make this happen, it needs to be a collaborative function to truly pull it off.
I think one of the important points that you just mentioned, and I don't think so this should go unnoticed, is like getting onto calls to understand the words that your customers speak. I think a lot of copywriting geniuses that we all know post on LinkedIn, they all happen to mention this point in their tips, that try and modify your copy to suit what your customers say. Use the words that they do it, and go look at reviews on G2, Crowdera, like be on customer calls, read a few customer emails, feedbacks, and then draft your copy for your marketing needs.
Exactly. And I mean, if you think about it, no, like people buy from people. And at the end of the day, we're not buying from robots. So like if I get to the point where I feel like it's very robotic on the other side, like that's just a huge turnoff. If you're talking to me like a human person, and we can kind of get together like that, it's going to make me want to buy your product more. And that's just the last thing I would say. You know, people buy from people, and everyone needs to realize that whether you're in marketing or sales.
Absolutely. Now, coming back to marketing leadership, I think part of it is also like setting your goals. Like, what's your go-to strategy when it comes to goal setting for marketing? How do you align your team, all your members to like look at one single North Star and then sort of break it down into different aspects for each one of them? What's your process?
Yeah, so I mean, I think it comes down to what's our ARR goal? Like, what are we trying to achieve? And then backing into that process. And the big thing for me is contribution to pipeline. So both from a source perspective as well as an influence perspective, there's other measurements, like you could take MQLs that play into it. I'm not a huge fan of only measuring MQLs, because at the end of the day, sales doesn't make money on MQLs. They don't care how many MQLs you get, because half the time marketing says I did my job, but sales doesn't think those are quality leads anyways. So when you're measuring contribution to pipe, it's a solid number that sales can relate to, that marketing says, okay, this is what we're contributing. And then you can create programs that are both, you know, middle of funnel, bottom of the funnel. What can we do to accelerate this pipeline as well as get top of funnel in? And if you're doing it by yourself, you're never going to get anywhere, but you should be developing these metrics and goals with the sales team. So you kind of come together as one revenue organization marching towards one goal.
Sure. And when you set a goal, how do you align or allocate your budgets? I mean, it's typically very difficult for a marketing leader to sort of get that additional budget for his quarter or for his entire year. How do you sort of do that ask, right, from your CEO or the CEO, whoever is the sanctioning in charge? And then how do you allocate that? Like, you look at quarter-wise, or do you see that, okay, that I'm going to be having certain spikes, certain occasions where I have to also splurge a little bit. Apart from your, of course, I'm talking about salaries that remain constant, anything that is apart from salaries.
Yeah, I mean, I think if you have the pipeline that you're contributing and you go and you can show quantifiable metrics that you're driving, I think that will help basically any increase in budget that you're asking for. And I mean, I think a huge piece of it's playing right now is on the digital side. I mean, that's where I would try to invest a good amount. And I mean, honestly, even video, and you know, I was telling you this before we went live, but anyone that sent me a personalized video as an outreach from a rep, I would take the meeting with them, because I can't tell you the number of messages that I get for that's basically a copy and paste from a script. And it's just like I put special pieces on my LinkedIn that tell people about me in hopes that if they reach out, they'll actually use that. And yeah. I would say 99% of the time, no one ever reads it. And I'm just giving people layups. Like, I'm willing to take meetings with people if they actually personalize something. And just, yeah. I don't know, maybe people are lazy, maybe they're just not into it, but it's unique quantifiable metrics to be able to ask for the budget. And then I would roll that into to digital side, especially, you know, search and SEO, PPC, things like that. And just, you know, trying to figure out, you know, what types of internal or I guess hosted events that you can do that will drive the needle versus trade shows as well.
Correct. Right. You just mentioned about receiving a video message. I happen to like speak with my colleague who heads enterprise sales for us at Gutch, and his name is Rahul. Shout out to him. He just mentioned that he was in touch with someone on LinkedIn. I don't happen to recollect the person, but then he was sending out text messages, and in return he received a video message from the other person, and he was like, wow, this wasn't expected. And he also recorded that video, he shared it with everybody on the team, and so it adds that amount of delight that, okay, you don't expect the other person to do something special like that, and it doesn't take a lot, right? It's just flipping your camera over and just being yourself on the camera. It adds so much more value than just writing some lines of text.
Exactly. And all you have to do is kind of look a little bit into the person to personalize it to them. I'm not asking for, like, you know, a book about my life, but just, you know that I like sports, know that I like baseball, know that I co-founded a baseball league. Like, if you mention that in a video, like, I may have no need for your product, but I'll at least have a meeting with you.
Correct. And good that you mentioned that. My next question was about that. Being a sports person, I also have been a sports person in my I've played badminton and basketball as a sport during my college and my early parts of my career. How does being a sports person help in your career, like in your job as a marketer and in general? Otherwise, also, like, I think the disciplinary aspect of being in life.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, it's made me super competitive. I think that's a huge piece of it. And it was funny because I wrote about this maybe like a month or two ago. And I said, you know, does being an athlete make you a better marketer? And a lot of people said there's a direct correlation between the two, where they do feel like the athletes that are out there are the best marketers because they're used to competing. They're used to like grinding. They're used to thinking outside the box to get it done. And honestly, it made me think a lot, because a lot of the topics and points that were brought up, I thought of myself and I was like, wow, this actually, like, I think it is true. And I try to do everything, you know, everything that I put into sports, I try to also put into my own personal life of just, you know, trying to work hard every day, trying to be better. And I think you can literally put all three of those things together and they can just kind of go hand in hand.
Absolutely. I cannot question that. I have to agree to whatever you said. Apart from that, as one more profession that I really feel adds a lot to the personality whenever you happen to switch over, and that is if you've served in the military, right? It brings so much more perspective. You're so much more focused and things like that.
Absolutely, yeah, I 100% agree with that.
Correct. So I want to talk about how Logs uses videos. If you were to just quickly tell me, and then I think starting from that webinar that you just did, there's no question that videos is something that is a luxury today. I think it's a must have for all the brands. Everybody is consuming so much more video. How does the strategy at Logs look like?
Yeah, so I mean, we just did a webinar with Holler, which is a customer of ours, and I think, you know, video specifically to also portray customer stories is important, because everyone can read a case study. But if you give me a 2-minute video of a customer case study that I can kind of consume how I want, I'll take visuals over text any day of the week. Like, it's just so much easier to understand and like just see. And I mean, not even just customer videos, but so Logs actually uses something of like YLogs, and it was video that basically our founders kind of put together. And it's just, it paints a picture that is very nice to follow. And we use that in a lot of the things that we do in like our follow-up, in our events that we do, in our webinars. We always try to tie it back to that video because it tells a nice picture of like what the company does, how we got started, how we solve the issues that everyone's facing today. So I 100% agree that video is, like you said, I think it's mandatory that businesses use, especially in the B2B market.
It's I mean, often looked at as a slightly more expensive asset to produce. I think everybody feels that it's very easy to write a blog, or like you said, write a 10-page case study or a white paper and sell, or even do it face to face. But oftentimes what happens is there are things that you want to refer and project to the person on the other side of the table. A story or a picture that you cannot really describe in words, and it's always better to show it in video.
Absolutely.
Let's talk about the community angle. Like every marketer would agree that building a community around what they do. For you, it would be around the usage of the EKL stack, right? ELK stack. The whole community around people who do that, how important is the aspect of like engaging in a community in general?
Yeah, I mean, honestly, I think community is huge. And so there's a couple of communities that I'm a part of on like the marketing side. And I'm going to give a huge shout out to Rev Genius here. So Jared and Galem, they started that. And I was one of the founding members of it. And we started as basically a LinkedIn group. And there was like 10 of us, and we were just kind of chatting. And then literally, I mean, it's only about, you know, 4 months old, and we're all at almost 6,000 members right now of sales, marketing, RevOps. It's huge. And the amount of people that I've met in there that has given me advice, both, you know, career wise, personal advice, it's tremendous. Like if you ask a question, people just jump on it and are willing to help you without really asking for anything in return. And I think that's something that I was always looking for as a marketer, is a community to basically talk to other marketers. And there was really nothing out there that specifically dealt with marketers. And now I have access to all, not only marketing, but all these sales and RevOps people that are out there too. And it's just, I've met a lot of amazing people. And one piece of advice to anyone that's not in a community, I highly suggest it, because it's just, there's roundtables, there's magazines with articles. Like, there's literally so much in Rev Genius that's out there that, you know, it would take hours to consume, but you should just dive in.
I personally spend a lot of time on Rev Genius reading up and connecting with people. I think the most amount of LinkedIn requests that I receive have a title of member at Rev Genius. it's so easy. It becomes so easy, and all of these guys are so accessible. I think the higher you go in your career, I think it becomes difficult to find people to seek advice from or get mentorship from, right? When you're at the start of the career, there are so many people above you to go and reach out to and get your questions solved, get your queries solved, ask some questions and things like that. But when you're possibly a director or a VP or a CMO, the amount of people that are in that position or above become like lesser and lesser. And also at the same time, the time is for every person in that kind of a role is very limited that they can offer. So having a community like this where you can actually reach out to people at your like your own peers or people who've been there and done that, I think it's super helpful, right?
Exactly. And that's the thing too. It's, you know, I've actually never had a mentor in my life up until about 6 months ago, maybe 7 months ago. And I've been trying to do this all on my own. And like, I didn't even know what a mentor really did. And now that I have actually a few people that have helped me a lot, specifically these last couple of months. And like, on top of that, just everyone in the community has been incredibly helpful. And it's just, you know, there's round tables to learn about different things. Like for me, like there's so many topics within marketing that like I want to learn about that. Like, you know, I don't know anything about SEO or PPC, but like there's other experts that are out there, and like just being able to sit and listen to them and like what they define important is valuable too.
Absolutely. I think it's equally important that you consume content and learn from the community, but also very important that you give back. Right. Yeah. Whatever you know, a lot of people say that I'm not really good at this, I'm not an expert at, like you said, PPC or SEO. But possibly somewhere down the line, it's all relative, right? You might be knowing better than a bunch of people out there. So when it comes to field marketing, I think you're one of the few people who are active on LinkedIn that pop up on my feed, and I think being a thought leader in marketing, I think it's very important that you put out your words of wisdom and give back to the community. I think you recently wrote an article on Rev Genius. What was that all about?
Yeah, so it was actually on sales and marketing alignment. And so I put that out there because it's something that I've seen done really poorly, and I've also seen it done really well. And like, I just want, it's a topic that has been talked about forever, but I think people try to just brush it under the rug and like, you know, it's, yeah, sales and marketing alignment, we get it. But do you really get it? Like, I think it's a topic that should constantly be talked about. And so I wrote the article for Rev Genius, and like the amount of feedback that I got from marketing leaders and sales leaders, I had people messaging me saying, this is 100% spot on, like couldn't agree more with you. That was all like, I couldn't, like, it was an amazing feeling to know that I did so well with it. And I'm looking to start to create some more articles around other pieces on field marketing, specifically around like Zoom fatigue with everything going on right now. But it was a really good feeling to know that I hit it right on the bullseye.
Absolutely. I think that article did pretty well. I've been reading a few comments, but then for those who've not read that article, or for those who are uninitiated about Rev Genius as a community, we'll drop both the links possibly in the comments after the podcast is over, so that people can have a look. But then maybe if you could just like give me a roundup of that article in like 3 points. What were the three important takeaways that anybody should know from that article about sales and marketing alignment?
Yeah, I think the first piece is developing goals together. You know, the ultimate goal is revenue. What are you going to do to get there? Marketing and sales should work jointly to develop those goals, and not like not only develop those goals, but develop what those actual numbers look like. The second piece, I think, is just making sure that you can speak sales' language. Like, you know, marketing could be doing their thing, but if you can't truly speak sales language and like what they what matters most to them, then you're just going to kind of get lost in the noise of everything else. And then I think lastly, it's just, you know, making sure the communication is there. Like, you need to have communication constantly, not just like, okay, I'm going to talk to my peers, you know, once every 2 weeks, once every 3 weeks. Like, you should be talking like daily with some of like your counterpart on the sales side, and then vice versa. If not daily, you know, at least once or twice a week. And if you're doing like those three things, it will help. But I mean, like I said, I've seen this a bunch, and I've only seen a few companies that 100% nail this like on the head.
Right. I think it's disastrous if both those functions are not aligned, right? I mean, salespeople could be targeting one set of clients and accounts, and marketing would be possibly doing something else altogether, and could be like a disaster for the company, right?
Exactly. Well, it's like, you know, it's the marketing team that develop an ABM plan without any input from sales. They just kind of say, okay, these are going to be our key accounts, but are they really sales's top accounts? Like, maybe not, but like, why wouldn't they have input from sales? Like, this is, it comes back to alignment. I'll preach that to any single person that asks me.
Right. I'd like to talk about the next topic that you just mentioned, and possibly you're going to be writing about this on RevGenius again, is like the Zoom fatigue, right? All of us have been working from home since the pandemic hit. And I think it's, I don't know, is it harder? Is it easier to work from home? What is it like?
So honestly, I've been working from home the last 7 years. So for me, it's easy. Like, I actually prefer working from home. I can get more work done. I can, you know, I've put measures in place that like I go for walks twice a day so that I don't burn out from just looking at a screen all day. Like, I have things that have helped me over the years that really like play a big piece of it. But I know there's people that they've never worked from home before, and like, it's not for everyone. And you have to have like, you have to have the strictness to be able to stay with it, because if not, you're just going to be like doing other things while you're trying to work. You're never going to get anything done. But honestly, even when the offices reopen again, I'll probably stay from home, but it'll be nice to have a place to go if I ever need to.
True. I think it's important, like you said, that you relax once in a while, stop looking at the screen, maybe take a walk or go for a baseball match, for all that it takes, right? Could be in your backyard, that is.
Yeah.
I recently picked up cycling, and that has been like a very good breakaway for me whenever I get fatigued. And then, of course, then this also brings me to the point that it has been so much more easier for us to reach out to anybody that we wanted to, right? If you were to like do a face-to-face meeting with someone who's not in your territory, today everybody is very open to just taking a video call with you. Like, just ask for a Zoom and they're like, yeah, why not? And that shows, right? I mean, I've been doing these podcasts, and a lot of people were very open to just saying that, okay, let's do it. People have been more open to being on video generally.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm with you. It's I mean, I've reached out to people just to try to like have a conversation. They're like, you want to hop on a video call real quick? I'm like, okay, sure. It's so much, it's way more convenient too than having to fly places. And like, I think it's going to change the way more of these executives like that are on planes all the time. Like, we've proven that we can do it through video. Like, why spend all this money on that? But
And you don't have to live out of a suitcase anymore.
Exactly. And you can eat healthier.
Right. And you also, like, the other advantage is that you also save a lot of time that you would possibly waste in traffic or things like that. You get to spend more time in with your family, with your loved ones. And how does that affect your morale while working?
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, it plays a huge piece of it, because my daughter is actually, she's 2 years old. So she's home every single day. And, you know, we have someone that watches her, but she's just in the other room. She's actually napping right now. And, you know, it's just nice to be able to go out into the other room and break up the day and say hi. And my wife gets home, you know, in the afternoon, and then, like, you know, being able to go for a walk with them and just kind of take some time to decompress. But one thing that's always been super important to me is from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m., I shut it off. I shut off my email. I shut off basically any technology. And that's the time that I'm present with my family. Like, I have dinner with them, and, like, I just kind of ask them about their day, and, like, all that other stuff can wait. And then I usually log back on after once my daughter's asleep. But if you can do that, I think it's important.
Awesome. Like, I'd like to say one last thing before we bring this conversation to the end. And I think the point is creating more content. A lot of people are shy of creating content, whether it is in text, whether it is video. I do. I'm a lot biased towards video, but the show is also called Mad Over Videos. Like a lot of people are shy of doing that, but the best marketers would tell you that hey, there's nothing better than creating a video, right? I want to ask you, why is Nick Bennett Mad Over Videos?
Absolutely, it's your chance to personalize and to connect with the other person. I mean, it's. I need to personally do more videos myself. I do it a bit, but it's like you said, it's so key. And the best marketers out there are the ones utilizing it to the best of their ability. And it just allows you to take the personalization to the next level.
Absolutely. This has been a great conversation. And I thank you so much from the bottom of my heart to, like, take out the time to do this. I think I'm going to be doing a lot more of these sessions, and I would like you to also point me to a few more people that you think should be on the show. Yeah, I think we'll have a lot of people from RevGenius as well, right?
Exactly. Yeah, no, this was fantastic. Thank you so much. I definitely have some amazing marketers that I can send your way.
Awesome. Thank you so much. And I'm going to catch up with you very soon.
Definitely. Thank you.